When war was declared on the 3rd of September 1939, there was a massive mobilisation across the whole of the British Isles. But it wasn't just the men and women signing up to fight. There was also the important issue of defending our own soil against possible invasion and occupation. Now, you might think that the Isle of Man, being so far from Germany, wasn't under any threat, but there were peculiar circumstances that made us vulnerable. And one of those was over there to the west, Ireland. Throughout the war, Ireland remained neutral. And even today, many Irish people still refer to the Second World War as the emergency. There was a fear in the British government that Germany might use Irish waters to attack the Isle of Man and establish a base here to launch further attacks on England. Nighttime bombing raids were a problem as well. England was in blackout, but Ireland wasn't. German bombers could use the lights of Dublin as a guide to bomb Belfast and Liverpool. Also, there were large numbers of military personnel stationed here during the war for training purposes, and there was always a fear that they might be attacked. In the months leading up to war, a huge range of plans was drawn up for the construction of thousands of buildings across Britain to prepare for war. There were pillboxes, radar stations, gunnery practice ranges, air raid shelters, and entire airfields. And all of these had to be built and made operational in a few short months. And here on the Isle of Man, the remains of some of these buildings still survive. One of the most common structures was the pillbox. They were usually six-sided and made of concrete. They were guard posts, and their shape apparently reminded people of the little boxes used in Victorian times for ladies to keep their pills in. In 1940, about 28,000 pillboxes were built across Britain, and many of the Manx ones still survive. This one here in the south of the island above Craigneish is typical. It's built of reinforced concrete, and it could withstand quite an assault. In fact, the reason so many of them have survived for more than 70 years is because they were so well built, and they've been too difficult to remove. Pillboxes were manned by soldiers and used to defend important installations from attack. At Craigneish, it was a nearby radar station. But in the north of the island, it was something much bigger. Pillboxes were often surrounded by great coils of barbed wire, making any attack difficult. And they had other features as well. They had loopholes around the outside for firing rifles through. And as you can see, the holes are splayed, which meant that the rifle could be swiveled from left to right. The hole the actual rifle was put through was therefore kept small, offering maximum protection to the soldier. There was a special design feature inside as well. Manx pillboxes had a rare web-shaped concrete structure in their centre, which was actually an anti-ricochet feature. If an enemy bullet did get in, it would get embedded in here, rather than bouncing all around. Over here, there's some ancient barbed wire that's probably been here since 1945. The whole of the pillbox would have been camouflaged with an earthen bank with soil and grass on its roof, and its purpose was to defend that. Jerby Airfield was surrounded by a network of 10 pillboxes, 9 of which still survive. There was a fear that Germans might be parachuted in to attack the airfield, and these pillboxes would have been the first line of defence. Of course, the airfields themselves were only really developed in the run-up to the war. There had been some basic facilities at Ronaldsway before then, but it was really in response to the war that they were developed. And like the others, the one here at Jerby was constructed on private farmland. It was started in 1937 and was eventually used for training thousands of men in gunnery, bombing, and all the technical issues they needed to know to be in the Royal Air Force. At times, it had as many as 65 aircraft here for training purposes. Some of the hardcore for the island's airfields was taken from the great piles of mining remains that were a feature of Foxdale and Laxey since the mines closed at the beginning of the century. Using them to make runways was ideal. Men that signed up for the Royal Air Force anywhere in Britain would end up at an airfield like Jerby. And there were quite a few throughout the British Isles, but Jerby had some particular features that made it attractive, such as being near the sea, so that coastal bombing ranges could easily be established. There were a whole range of buildings associated with Jerby Airfield. There were guardhouses, decontamination rooms, officers' mess, sleeping quarters, air raid shelters, parachute stores, and many more. Today, most of them have disappeared, but one or two have survived. This is the original guardhouse, and anyone coming onto Jerby Airfield would have been challenged and identified here. Some of the more humble buildings that survive are the tractor shed, the vehicle shed, the powerhouse, which had diesel generators in it, and the bombing teacher building. If you were going to bomb over Germany, then you needed to know how to find your targets on a dark night, and how to get the height and speed right for a direct hit. This is one of the few remaining trench air raid shelters where up to 50 men could hide in case of an attack. It's brick-lined, it's 4 feet wide and it's 50 feet long, and it's camouflaged from the air with a great grass bank. There were 17 of these shelters around the airfield, and over 800 people could take cover in them if there was an attack. Here's the turret trainer building. Inside, there would have been an early type of simulator, projecting a picture of German aircraft flying through the sky. Trainees would sit in a mock gun turret and learn to aim and hit the images. In the rush to develop Jerby Airfield in recent years as a light industrial area, many of the wartime buildings have been demolished, though a handful of the most important ones have been legally protected, and the most important one of all still stands. Fortunately, this building has survived and it's in excellent condition. It's the watch office, or as they call it, flying control, and from here all movements on the airfield were monitored. Flying control still retains some of its original features. Hidden away on the eastern side of the airfield is this extraordinary building, and it's all still here. It's the bomb store. Behind these great doors, the live bombs were kept. They were swung out on these rails, loaded onto trucks, and taken off to the waiting aircraft. Although no bombing raids were undertaken from Jerby, it was important for the trainees to know how to handle the explosives and how to load them onto aircraft. Because this was such an important installation, it was surrounded by four pillboxes and a huge earthen bank, which would have acted as a blast protection if any of the bombs had gone off accidentally. The flat plain at the north of the island was ideal for airfields, which the RAF took full advantage of. Not only was Jerby operational, but a second airfield was built just a few miles away at Andreas. This airfield served a number of purposes. fighter squadrons were stationed here as part of their training, and occasionally they would go up and engage with German bombers making raids on Belfast and Glasgow. One of the squadrons stationed at Andreas for a period was the colourful Australian 457 squadron, all of whose aircraft had distinctive decoration. As the war progressed, an air gunnery school was also set up at Andreas, and many of the buildings associated with these activities are still here. For example, this is the remains of the machine gun test range, now full of modern junk. Aircraft would have been tethered here and test-fired their guns into the back wall, which, in the 1940s, would have been covered by inch-thick metal sheets to absorb the bullets. The thing about Andreas Airfield is that it was a dispersed airfield with E-pens. Let me explain. A dispersed airfield means that the planes were pulled to the side of the runway when they weren't being used, unlike a modern airport where they'd all be together at the terminal. The point of this was, if the airfield came under attack from German bombers, then there was less likelihood of the planes all being hit at once. If they were together and one exploded, then they'd all be lost. It also meant that enemy aircraft would have to pass backwards and forwards repeatedly to pick all the planes off, thereby exposing themselves to a greater chance of being shot down. But the aircraft here weren't just pulled to the side and left out in the open. They were stored in specially constructed E-pens. These were huge earthen banks shaped like a giant letter E with a curved back. The aircraft were towed into the space between the banks. Because the airfield hasn't been used for 70 years, the E-pens are now really overgrown with gorse, but you can just make out the shape of the one that's here. There's a modern mobile phone mast there now, of course, but at the back you can see the shape of the letter E running down to where that skip is, and the centre of the letter is sticking out here. It was on the tarmac areas there that the aircraft were parked for protection. Looking down on the airfield from above, the shape of the E-pens is still visible. Grouped in clusters of three, there were 12 in all, with each pen accommodating two aircraft. After landing, the aircraft would be pulled into the pens for protection and servicing. If you look at the construction of the banks that make up the pens, then you can see they are largely earth and gravel. But there's something else about their construction which was critical. If you look over there, you can see a brick doorway. That's because the E-pen is constructed around a brick tunnel and packed over with earth. The idea of that was an air raid shelter. If you happened to be working on your aeroplane out here and you suddenly came under aerial attack, then you could run into there for protection. They never were actually used in an air raid because Andreas was never attacked. Even so, the detail of their construction just shows what an extraordinary amount of building was undertaken throughout Britain so quickly in the run-up to war. So those are the E-pens, but just look at this. It's incredible. So much tarmac. It's amazing to think that all this is hidden away in the Manx countryside. I'm standing at the apex of two of the three runways. The extraordinarily wide and long runways allowed planes as big as the American Flying Fortresses to make emergency landings here as they came in off the Atlantic patrols looking for U-boats. And because Andreas is privately owned, it's meant that although many of the buildings are derelict, most of them and the runways are still here. And it's still possible to make out what they were for. This is flying control, not restored like the one at Jervey, but still a magnificent building. This is station headquarters, from where all the administration of the airfield was run. Every group of E-pens had a flight office where the flight commander worked with his administrative staff. and every group of E-pens had a sleeping shelter where 48 men slept in two rows of steel bunks.
This bit of tarmac is actually more interesting than it looks. You might think it's just a road, but in fact it was all part of the scheme to camouflage the airfield. They wanted to make Andreas difficult to spot if you were enemy aircraft. And the way they did this was to build fake roads, to tone down the surface of the runways, and to actually paint fake field boundaries on the surrounding grass to camouflage the whole site.
This is a rare photograph taken at the time, and you can see that it's quite difficult to make out the three runways, as hedges and fake roadways have been painted across them. And often this was done just using engine oil. The north of the island was intensely used by the RAF all through the war. Along this coast there was a series of target practice areas. Bombers and gunners would fly over from Andreas and Jervey towards specially designed targets floating on rafts out to sea. A series of wooden towers along the coast housed observers who tracked the whole exercise to see how accurate the firing was. This training was vital for these men as they prepared to go to Europe to join the war. Behind Jervey Church was a rather strange setup, a gunnery practice range. This was for turret gunners, the men sitting at the front or rear of bombers fighting off the Luftwaffe. The footings of a building are still here, and on this spot was a replica of a turret gun that men would sit in and practice firing. They were facing towards the sea, and at the other end of the field was a long wall with an earthen bank in front of it. Behind the wall ran a small railway, which carried a target on it, made to look like an enemy fighter. It was this the men were trying to hit. Much of this setup has since eroded into the sea, but part of the concrete wall with its protective bank is still here.
As you can imagine, if the turret gun was over there and the target was running past there, then this bank should be full of thousands of bullets that actually miss the target. And indeed, if you dig long enough, you can actually find the occasional bullet. This is probably sat here for 70 years.
There were other extraordinary additions to the landscape as well, which were vital to the war effort. The remains of one particular system are difficult to miss and can still be seen in coastal areas from Castletown to as far north as Bride.
Under this camouflage of earth and gorse is a massive concrete structure, just one of a number in the fields around here. They were actually radar stations, and they formed part of a chain of such stations right up the British Isles. There are three others on the Isle of Man, at Dalby, at Scarlet, and at Craignish. They were manned 24 hours a day during the war, and they were searching for enemy aircraft.
Strictly speaking, it wasn't actually radar. In the 1940s, radar was still being developed, some of it secretly on the Isle of Man. So a much more primitive system was being used to detect unauthorised aircraft.
In the fields around here were huge masts over 300 feet high. Some were transmitting and some were receiving. And the resulting information was fed into these bunkers, allowing the operators to get a fix on the enemy aircraft.
By carefully measuring the time lag between the signal going out and its reflection back off the moving object, the position of the aircraft could be calculated. If it was suspicious, the information was fed to a central control in England and action was taken. The masts were a dramatic addition to the countryside, and at Niarbal they dominated the landscape. The winches used to stand them up are still there, and in some fields, the concrete blocks which tethered them down are still there. The bunkers were carefully constructed to be sealed from the outside and had airlocks. All the air coming in and out was filtered against possible gas attacks.
Filtering the air was most important, and most of the equipment is still here. These trunks brought the air in from outside, which was then filtered through this unit. In this room, there would have been banks of oscilloscopes displaying the readings from the giant masts outside, and above here, a huge canopy that took away the heat from the instruments below. Elsewhere on the island, activity was just as intense. Ronaldsway Airport was also a creation of the Second World War. Nowadays, as the island's commercial airport, it has all the most modern facilities. But back in the early 1940s, it was very basic indeed. It was used by the Fleet Air Arm, which is a branch of the Royal Navy. They're responsible for flying the aircraft that are based on ships, such as aircraft carriers, and they're quite separate from the Royal Air Force. In 1943, they established a land-based ship here at Ronaldsway, which they called HMS Early. And from contemporary photographs, you can see how basic it was compared with the airport today. The living quarters for all the trainees were actually here at Janet's Corner on the road into Castletown. In recent years, it's all been done up with splendid new housing, which replaced the houses that were here after the war. Those in turn had replaced the original Nissen huts that were put on what was an empty field as HMS Early was being built. This is what Janet's Corner originally looked like. Nissen huts were prefabricated buildings that could be put up quickly and cheaply for various purposes, and they were ideal for wartime. And the sleeping conditions were rather, well, cramped. The only vestige of those wartime buildings that remains today is this, the British Legion Hall. But in the 1940s, it was the centre for entertainment for the camp, and many shows were put on in here. It wasn't just airfields that the Isle of Man accommodated during the war. There were many other just as important facilities. Here on Douglas Head, there was another land-based ship, HMS Valkyrie, run by the Royal Navy to train cadets in the secrets of radar. The building that now houses Manx Radio was specifically built to train the cadets in the developing harbour radar, and Douglas Head itself was bristling with antennae and masts. The 30,000 or so graduates that left the school during the war went on to operate radar on submarines, battleships, and all types of warships. Their living quarters were in the hotels on Lock Promenade, behind the barbed wire. Further along the prom, the hotels that had housed internees in the first years of the war were now converted to a top-secret training facility for men and women to learn Morse code. From here, they went on to stations in the UK to intercept German communications, which were then sent to the famous Bletchley Park for decoding on the Enigma machines. So you can see the Isle of Man was teeming with activity during the war. It wasn't just the three new airfields, but a series of radar stations, turret and gunnery training areas, and a secret school for training codebreakers. Tens of thousands of military personnel were trained on the island during the war, and the Isle of Man made a significant contribution to Britain's war effort.